Good morning to all. This is Balamurugan Consulting Faculty in Kingmaker IAS Academy, and I am here to discuss about the Good Morning Test on the 23rd April 2020. The very first question which deals with the World Press Freedom Index 2020. As far as the index or report is concerned, definitely there will be one questions from the UPSC in index or report and something. So it needs to be interpreted in two ways. First, index or report, it need to be learned or need to know or need to know the two aspects. One is prelims aspect and the mains aspect. As far as the prelims aspect is concerned, we need to ask the three questions. Who is the authority to release particular index and what it actually indicates? How will you this particular index is calculated? What are the parameters that is considered in calculating this particular index? What is the position of India in the global scenario? These kind of the four questions that we need to ask first as main aspect of prelims aspect. Depending upon the gravity of the situation and the report of our index and anything which is more important for the socio-economic issues, or anything which is more serious in concern and which will be helpful for in the good governance or developing certain things from the bad condition to good condition. So we can move on to the next step. That is, we can move on or adapt any other strategies or methodology to improve the particular thing. Only because of the data that we have, that kind of the data is derived from the credible institutional mechanism in the global scenario. In this aspect, the particular index is concerned, we need to keep up the important factual information about the particular index. It will be helpful for to write the mains answer writing. It will give you the picture, you supporting or suggesting some point whether the factual or statistical evidence shall be. So here we are going to discuss about the World Press Freedom Index 2020. First question we need to ask, who is the authority to release the particular index? This is definitely we need to know the very first information. As far as this particular press freedom index is concerned, so we can't come to the conclusion in the sense which is UNESCO, whether it will be whether the UNESCO activities is aligned with the any of the perspective of press freedom or the journalism in the sense. It's not at all UNESCO has done much role in this aspect. So you can easily eliminate this particular question, particular option. So we can mostly deal with the CRD. So this is as far as this particular is concerned, Report Without Border. This is the non-profit organization which released the authority, which released the index of World Press Freedom Index. Second, what it indicates? It's as far as the democracy is concerned. As far as democracy is concerned, press freedom is the greatest pillar of democracy. One of the greatest pillar of democracy. So in this press freedom is actually decides how much liberty and freedom of expression and right to information is available in this country. Actually, the freedom of expression is guaranteed under Article 19 of Indian Constitution. So as far as this good governance aspect is concerned, we need to keep it this mnemonics, that is SMART. The governance mechanism to be simple in character, which will be in the affordable and availability and accessibility of the public services to the people. And second thing, it needs to be in the line of the modern technological aspect. Modern and technological aspect, it should be in the scientific analysis in taking the any of the measure which need to taking solution regarding the any of the problem. A is for accountability and R is for responsibility, T is for transparency. The transparency which will be ensured by the freedom of expression and the right to information available and the right to information perspective. So how far it is transparent, it decides the accountability of the government. How far it is accountable, it shows the how far it is responsible to the people. That is responsibility of the entire, the five principles of the good governance is mainly deal with the press freedom index. So this press freedom index actually indicates the free fair journalism or free fair just freedom of expression or situation which will be helpful to ensure the press freedom in the country. So in this aspect, this particular index indicates that out of 180 country, India is in the rank of 142. Actually in this year it has dropped the, in this particular year, in this particular press freedom index, India is to be ranked 142. It's a dropped two positions. It's like 2019 it's absolute no murder related to journalism. In 2008 is concerned, it's actually six cold-blooded murder which happened particularly on journalist. So in this aspect, the no murder has happened on this particular in this year 2019, which does not mean that the press freedom condition is improved in our country. It's actually its ranking is dropped to two rankings. So the 142 rank out of the 180th country is not at all the good ranking as far as the press freedom is concerned. So as I said earlier, if you want to judge the good governance mechanism of the particular country, we need to scrutinize the governance activities in five aspects. That is the simplicity of the governance and accessing and availing of the government services to the people. And second thing, it's modern, that should be in scientific lines. Last three, it's mostly deal with the press freedom, as that is responsibility, accountability and transparency. The transparency is mainly decided by the right to freedom of expression and the right to information aspect. The transparency, which mainly lies with the press freedom, it ensure the accountability. Once you ensure the transparency and accountability, then only you can show the how much responsible this particular governance mechanism to the people. So in this aspect, India is ranking 142 out of the 180. In the sense, it's not a good thing. We need to move further. And as far as, and third interpretation that need to have as far as index is concerned, how the particular index is calculated, what are all the parameters that taken into consideration to calculate this particular index. Since first is pluralism, and second thing is media independence, and third thing is the environment and self-censorship, and fourth thing is the legislative framework and the constitutional rights that ensure the freedom of index and transparency. And fourth is infrastructure and the abuses on the journalism people. So these seven parameters have been taken into consideration in calculating World Press Freedom Index. In this aspect, Norway is the first, ranked first in this Press Freedom Index. And China is the 177th, a very pathetic situation. And North Korea in the sense is 180th condition. It does not mean that we can compare with the China or any of the countries which are far behind the India in the calculating index. If you want to move to upgrade further, if you want to develop further, we need to look into the positions. We need to look into the countries which are above the India in this particular index. So we have completed a very clear definition about the index and report, and as also the press freedom in this country. So it is reported by the, it's released by the Reporters Without Borders. So it's a non-profit organization founded in the 1985. It works on safeguarding the right to freedom of information, and this particular organization is aimed to promote the independent, free and pluralistic journalism, as well as to defend the media workers in this country around the in the entire globe. So we have completed the first question. We will move on to next question. And consider the following statement regarding the COVID India Seva in the sense. As I said in the previous sessions, the as far as the e-government's initiative is concerned, is very, very essential part. You can keep in mind the three or four kind of the interpretation that we need to have while reading the government initiatives or schemes or any or policy measures or the e-government initiatives. So in this aspect, first one is what is the objective of that particular initiative, and who is the nodal agency, what is the benefits which are going to be availed by the citizen of India, What are the eligibility condition to avail the particular government services? In this aspect, the COVID India Seva. This COVID India Seva, it's a direct channel of communication between the government and the citizens, mainly to provide the real-time basis solution to the COVID-19 related queries. So it's actually exclusively set up to in order to address the grievances and the queries which are related to the COVID-19 impact. Mostly it creates certain anxiety and fear factor or any of the psychological aspect or any other question which needs to be asked regarding the COVID-19. So which will be helpful for the strengthen the emotional strength of the people, and it will be the direct channel of the communication between the government and the citizen. It is actually launched by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So answer is C, both 1 and 2 are correct. Doctor, why it is in the news in the Dr. Harshavardhan, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare launches the COVID India Seva, the interactive platform for citizen engagement, as we discussed earlier. It's aimed at enabling transparent e-governance delivery in the real time and answering the citizens' queries swiftly at the scale, especially in the crisis situation of ongoing COVID-19 impact. This is all the information about these particular COVID-19 India Seva. Basically, it's a communication channel which will be helpful to address the grievances and the doubts and queries raised by the people. This comes under the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And we move on to next question with respect to Swayam Prabha. This is also the questions which deals with e-government initiatives. It provides education through the DTH channels across the entire country on 24/7 basis. So this is what it's a aim. If it is true, is it something which is related to education on DTH channel across the country for 24/7 basis, definitely it will come under the Ministry of Charity. So if the statement 2 is absolutely correct, if statement 1 is also correct, there is more possibility as far as statement 2 is concerned. Statement 1 is also right. So in this questions, these are both statement are correct. So what is the Swayam Prabha? What is the news? Why it is this particular question has been asked? The review meeting has been done by the Ministry of Charity in order to increase the online and digital educational platform to the people. In this review meeting, the government decided that 190,900 Swayam courses and 60,000 Swayam Prabha videos will be translated into 10 regional languages. It will be made ensure that students can take advantage of the online educational program by the Ministry of Charity. This particular Swayam Prabha channel is a group of 32 DTH channels devoted to telecasting of the high quality educational program on 24/7 basis using the GSAT-15 satellite. So it at least 4 hours per day which will telecast the education related online classes, which will repeated on the 5 more times in a particular day, which will make convenient time to read or listen or grasp the particular educational benefits of the particular educational online courses. This is the initiative of the Ministry of Charity. So statement 2 is also correct. It's aimed at making quality learning resources accessible to the remote areas where the internet availability is still a challenge. So this is what information about this Swayam Prabha. Swayam Prabha is simply seeing TV and learning certain things. This is what simply we can infer. And how can it, if you speak very technically, it's a group of 32 DTH channel which will be helpful to provide the education related online classes at least 4 hours per day, which will teach the online classes 5 times with a 5 slot per day. The students which can adapt any of the time which will be comfortable for him or her, they will adapt to any of the one particular time they can watch the online classes. This is what intention began the initiative of Swayam and Swayam Prabha. So in this COVID-19 impact, the entire country is locked down, and so this will be helpful to enrich the educational facilities to the people. This is what information about the Swayam Prabha. I hope everyone understand the Swayam Prabha question. We will move on to next question. Now consider the following statement regarding national agricultural market, that is particular national agriculture market in bracket E norm. say electronic platform which will be helpful to enhance the public service delivery electronic platform. So national agriculture market in the sense, first word it means at national and second word is agriculture, third word is market. The market in the sense it is a place where buying and selling has happening. So here we are going to what kind of the commodities that needs to be purchased and the sold. In the sense agriculture product and commodities that is going to be purchased and they sell in this platform. National wide in this aspect, it's transcending the state borders. It will link the most of the states and most of the union territories of agriculture APMC mandis. So it's a collective platform which will be helpful to increase the accessibility of the market facilities for the people, for the farmers, and which will be helpful to the increasing the scope of the market for the farmers. So this is what information we can infer from the ENAM. So it networks the existing APMC mandi to create the unified national market for the agriculture commodities, as we discussed. That is, statement one is correct. As we said earlier, any of the initiatives we need to interpret in the four aspects. What is the objective of particular scheme, and second, who is the authority, fourth one is what is the benefits that are going to be availed by the citizen of India under this particular scheme, what are the eligibility condition to avail the particular benefits under the scheme. These kind of the four interpretation we need to have as far as the any government initiative is concerned. In this aspect, Small Farmers Agriculture Consortium is the implementing agency of the ENAM. So second statement is also correct. It covered by the all states and the union territories. Whenever they use the word all, only, or never, ever, these are the very, very important terms that needs to have a extra consciousness and the extra cautiousness all in this particular dealing with particular statement. Whether you are very clear about this particular statement, then only you have to touch the particular question. Otherwise, you need to skip the question because it's mostly most of the twist in this particular question align with these statements. So we need to be a double C, that is consciousness along with the cautiousness. So in this aspect, how far it is useful for the states and the union territories, we will see in the explanation part. Why it is in the news, more than 75 lakh trucks and transporters linked to the ENAM. So have electronic portal which networks the existing Small Agriculture Consortium, the implementing agency. 585 mandis and 16 states and 2 union territories have been integrated in the ENAM portal, which will soon expanded to cover the additional 450 mandis. So it's only covers the 16 states and 2 union territories. It does not mean that which will cover the all the states and all union territories. So the statement 3 is incorrect. So answer is 1 and 2 only. Answer is A. So if we take this particular government initiatives in this market aspect is consists, what are the benefits that can be in the sense it increase the market scope or increase the accessibility of the market. Which will be helpful for the transparency in this quantity of demand and supply of particular material. It will enhance the cashless economy, which means formalization of activities in economical activities, eliminating the intermediaries, which will be helpful directly to the farmers. These are all the benefits which can be attained from this initiative of ENAM. And fourth most important is ENAM say access to soil testing and provides the elementary amenities for sorting and packing to the farmers. It's very important in this ENAM initiatives. So as we said, provide information and trading of and then aggregate the quantity of supplies, provide cashless instruction, etc. So these are all the benefits which are going to be attained by the ENAM initiatives, and we will move on to next question. We have completed the discussion about the ENAM. This is very important question. Long term repo operation. So first we need to know about the what is repo operation. What is repo in the sense? Repurchase option. This repo rate we can classify as repo rate and reverse repo rate. These two terms is collectively called as liquidity adjustment facility, LEF. It's what is repo rate in the sense is the rate at which commercial bank like SBI or any other bank, the rate at which the commercial bank can get loan from the central bank of the country like RBI. If it is in the reverse in character, that is the reverse repo rate, it is the rate at which RBI can get the borrowings amount from the commercial bank. This is what reverse repo rate. This mostly it will in the short term in character. It will change it frequently in order to get the price stability and the inflation control methods, and also enhance the proper money supply around the country. These are all the monetary mechanism which will be used by the RBI in order to enhance the monetary stability in this country. As we discussed about the basic information about the repurchase option, here the term include, we already discussed that liquidity adjustment facility, that is repo rate and reverse repo rate, which is short term in character. So which actually short term in character, which actually helpful to get the monetary stability or price stability in this country. It's frequently changed over the period of the time depending upon the country economical situation and money value in the country. So in this aspect we added the word of long term. So then what is the need for long term repo operation? So why it will added the point of the term long term to the repo operation? So firstly they will provide the long term loan. This is what we can infer from this particular wordings, long term repo operations. So the repo operation we have now discussed the long term sense. The central bank of the country is going to provide loan to the commercial bank in the long term manner, that is it's mostly it will take 1 to 3 years maturity period at the rate of repo rate. So as far as the repo rate or reverse repo rate is concerned, is mostly it's a 2 months or 1 month or 3 months, that such kind of the short term has been taken into consideration in regarding the fixing the basis point of the repo rate or a reduction or increasing in the basis point of the repo rate. But in long term, it indicates that the durability, the maturity of the loans will be 1 to 3 years at the rate of repo. This is what long term reverse operation. It's actually why this particular scheme was introduced by the central bank of the country, in the sense in this country demand is very low because the money supply is low in this country because lockdown, COVID-19 impact. This is the situation. We need to pump the more money to the people, then only we can enhance the demand and the boost to the economy. Then only central bank of the country decided to pump more money to the market to the people. So that's why the RBI has introduced the long term reverse operation. With this information we can go into the statement like liquidity adjustment facility. It is a tool that allows the banks to borrow 1 to 3 years of the fund from the central bank at the repo rate. It's every information which are in the second part. This is first part, like liquidity adjustment facility. This is second part. You just read the first statement. It is the tool that allows the bank to borrow 1 to 3 years fund from the central bank at the repo rate. This is what we have discussed, the long term repo rate operation. So second part is absolutely correct. Whether the second part is alike with the liquidity adjustment facility. Liquidity adjustment facility mostly confined to the short term in character. It's not at all deal with the long term in character. So it's not like liquidity adjustment facility. So first statement is wrong. And second, this kind of the mechanism was first introduced by the European Central Bank. Whether it will be as far as the entire the global economy is concerned, this such kind of the monetary tool, such kind of the monetary mechanism, which has been first time introduced by the European Central Bank. Second statement is correct. The LTRO, long term reverse operation, was first introduced by the European Central Bank during the debt crisis that began in the 2018. So this such kind of the monetary mechanism adopted by the our own central bank, that is RBI, in order to enhance the market, in order to enhance the money supply in this country. So that's why RBI came with the scheme of long term repo operation. Why it is in the news sense? Recently, it has came up with the two important information regarding long term repo operation. First is the include long term repo operation. They added the word targeted. So if you avail the loan under this particular scheme, you need to specifically invested in the investment grade corporate area. Specifically invested in the investment grade corporate debt. This is why targeted LTRO. And second thing is, the RBI has allowed banks to exclude the loan extend to the NBFC. So banks providing the loans to the NBFC, which has been excluded from the term of long term repo operation. This is the first information from the RBI. And second information from the RBI, in the sense, the loan under this long term repo operation needs to be specifically invested in the investment grade corporate area. This kind of the two information which has been in the news, that's why the question has been asked from the long term repo operation. So this particular question is concerned, answer is Bombay, two only. First statement is correct, wrong. Why? In the sense, it has the two component. First part is like liquidity adjustment facility, and second part which provide amped definition of what is LTRO, and it not at all is like liquidity adjustment facility, because liquidity adjustment facility is mostly in the short term in character. So answer is two only. Now we have completed the 50% of the GMT test, and I hope everyone will have an idea about the first five questions of today's DNC. We will move on to sixth questions. With respect to Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council, so very too long institution or council. First, it's a Technology Information Forecasting Assessment Council. It deals with the technological information which will be helpful forecast and assessment of the assess the gravity of the situation, and then it will provide the suggestion what kind of the steps that can be taken. This is what information we can infer from the name, technology information and second forecasting, and third assessment council. So if it is the technological information or technological promotion or technological development, it definitely they may control the Department of Science and Technology, and it is mandated to assess the state of our technology and set directions for the future technological development in India. In this aspect, what kind of why it is in this particular institutional is asked in this particular year, in this question GMT, in the sense. Every year there will be one question from the institutional mechanism which will be more significant, environment and the economical perspective mostly. And here, so in this aspect, we will focus on the one of the institutional mechanism in this GMT test. So why this particular institution is chosen to take the question, in the sense, already India is impacted on the COVID-19 impact. So what will be the post-COVID-19 impact in the revival of Indian economy? So to revive the Indian economy, what are the measures to be taken to boost the Indian economy? In this aspect, the Technological Information Forecasting Assessment Council released their own white paper. This particular white paper They released the white paper on the what are the measures to be taken to boost the Indian economy and the post COVID-19 impact. They will came with the two aspect. One is normative aspect and explorative measures that needs to be taken to boost the Indian economy. This kind of the white paper is came by the with support of Technological Information Forecasting and Assessment Council. Why, that's why this particular institutional mechanism has been asked in this GMT test. This particular institution is come under the control of Department of Science and Technology. So it will provide the technological aspect, what kind of the measures it support to boost the economy in the sense. As usual, it's strengthening the Make in India and commercialization of the indigenous product and transparent efficient PDS system and the rural healthcare services and the reduction in the import and adoption of the emergent technology domains. This is what main focus of this particular institutional advice. So this particular organization was formed in 1985. Technology Policy Implementation Committee recommendation would be helpful to form the TIFAC, Technology Information and Forecasting Assessment Council, till formed in the 1986. This is what information about the TIFAC. This particular institution, whether so important for UPSC as question in the sense, I don't know. Because the such kind of the institutional mechanism can be asked or never can be asked. Nobody has going to judge exactly this particular institution related question will come in the UPSC. It's not like that. But we can have keep in mind while reading the newspaper, this kind of the interpretation and the institutional learning that you need to adapt while reading the newspaper. This is what the intention behind the question asking from the institutional mechanism in the GMT test. I'll move on to next question. Answer the following statement regarding Feluda. What is Feluda? We don't know anything about it. It's a low cost and pepper strip test which can detect the new coronavirus within the hour. Within the hour. This is very, very important. And second, the test is based on the bacterial immune system protein called the Cas19. First, it's as is discussed in the first 21 April discussion, COVID-19 can be tested by the two tests. One is antibodies test, another one is reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction test. In this, coronavirus is the component of the RNA genome sequencing. It will infiltrate in the host cell and take control of this particular cell and used as a virus producing factory, and it also filled with the RNA genome sequencing. So in this test, polymerase chain reaction test, we need to transcript the coding into DNA genome sequencing. So we need to change the genome sequencing from the RNA to the DNA. This kind of the transcription is called as a reverse transcription. Then we will subject to the polymerase chain reaction test. In this mechanism, we are going to introduce the Cas9 protein system with the cutting edge technology mechanism regarding genome in this particular diagnosis of the coronavirus. So it inclusion of the Cas9 technology in the testing of the RT-PCR, which will be helpful to find out the diagnosis within the hour whether the particular person is affected by the coronavirus is not. It is this particular initiatives is this particular initiative has been taken by the CSIR, that is Institute of Genomics and the Integrative Biology, and it will helpful for the within hour. So first statement is correct. Its second statement is also because it's cutting edge gene editing tool CRISP or Cas9 system, which will be helpful for the diagnosis of the COVID-19 genetic material. It can be done rapidly and use the DNA basic community healthcare. This is our major goal, to make it as simple as so that it can widely and easily used. Why this name Feluda is chosen? It's inspired from the Satyajit Ray characters. That is, it's a detective character, spy detective character is named as the Feluda. This name is this particular name is given to this particular testing mechanism, that is Cas19 testing mechanism. So once again I will tell about the Feluda. Feluda is a low cost paper strip test mechanism which will test the person within the hour whether if the person is affected by the coronavirus or not. Mostly in the RT-PCR test, they used the protein Cas9 protein genome cutting editing tool, which will be helpful to identify the diagnosis of the particular person. This is what information we can get from these Feluda, about Feluda. The Feluda, the name is inspired from the Satyajit Ray detective fictional character. So we'll move on to next question. So this COVID-19 impact, the classical swine flu, it's a disease, it's a great tragedy on the Assam region. 1,300 pigs have been died due to the classical swine flu. This is the great information, this is the news regarding the classical swine flu. It's a contagious and it provides the fatal to the species. It's a great threat on the poultry farmers and farmers who depend upon animal husbandry, because 1,300 pigs, it's a huge number as far as the pig related economical activities is concerned. So this is first statement, is this is a contagious viral disease of domestic and wild swine. That is correct. It's humans are not affected by this particular virus. This is also correct. So answer is both 1 and 2. So amid pandemic, 1,300 pigs die of the swine flu in the Assam. So 5 districts of the eastern Assam is affected with the classical swine fever. It's a heavy impact on the poultry based farming economy. So and other information we have discussed, it's also known as hog cholera. Its syndromes are the body temperature, a rise in body temperature. So characterized by the high body temperature first, and lethargy and feeling of laziness, and yellowish diarrhea and vomiting sense, and discoloration of the skin of ears and the lower abdomen and legs. These are all the syndromes of the classical swine flu. So it's a great tragedy or pathetic situations to the people of farmers who are depend upon the economical activities. This is what information about the classical swine flu. So we will move on to next question. And this is also e-government initiatives with the consider the statement of Vidyadhan 2.0. It's a contribute to the e-learning content. Yes, it's a help the children continue to the learning anywhere at any time in the country. That is also correct. It's launched on Diksha portal platform and the Ministry of Human Resources Human Resources Development. So this statement is also correct. So answer is both 1 and 2. Both 1 and 2. This more so answer is C. So very direct statement and simple question. You can easily answer for this question. So how do you interpret? How do you analyze the particular e-government initiative? In the sense, as I have discussed the earlier questions. You just go back and learning the methodology to interpret the particular question in regarding the while assessing the particular e-government initiatives. Okay, so Vidyadhan 2, it's related with e-learning content and helpful for the children in the education aspect. We have come to the last part of this GMT test discussion. In this test, Himalayas are spread. First statement, 10th question is always we asked from the one of the previous year UPSC questions. In India, Himalayas are spread over only 5 states. So as we said earlier, this is the double C statement. Double C means you need to be conscious, otherwise cautious, and also cautious. As far as the word contains only, all or never, some kind of the absolute terms. Glaringly see that Himachal Pradesh, it covers more than 5 states: Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Assam, Sikkim, West Bengal, Arunachal Pradesh. It's a trans Himalayas and Himathri Himachal Shivalik and Purvachal ranges. These are all considered to be the Himalayan mountains. So definitely it will covers more than 5 states. So the first statement is absolutely wrong. Second statement is concerned is the Western Ghats. Western Ghats deals with Gujarat and Maharashtra and Goa and Karnataka and Kerala and Tamil Nadu. it covers the six states. So the statements will spread over five states only. So this statement is also wrong. And second, the Pulikat Lake spread to two states only. Yes, it's Andhra Pradesh plus Tamil Nadu. 60% of lakes lies in Tamil Nadu, 40% of lakes in the Andhra. This is what about the Pulikat Lake. So 3 only is the correct. So answer is Bombay, 3 only. So this is what interpretation about this particular question. Definitely there will be one question from the physiography or map related questions in India related map question, and otherwise global aspect, it deals with the border, sea border states, bordering states, bordering of sea in global scenario. These are all the questions from the map area. So we have completed the today GMT discussion. I hope everyone understand the every each and question of this today GMT. And I once again asked everyone should follow the GMT test regularly, and also request you to practice regularly and be safe, and use this time to improve and also to strengthen the physical, intellectual and emotional strength of your own. So thank you. We will meet on the tomorrow GMT test.